Let's put ourselves in the presence of the Lord. Heavenly Father, we come to you in this hour asking for your guidance and protection to our virtual gathering today. We thank you for the gift of life, the gift of family, the gift of work, and the gift of friendship. We thank you for this great opportunity to bring us together in this session as brothers and sisters. Bless the committee, the facilitator, and the attendees of this gathering. May we continue to value and appreciate the true essence and meaning of life with the help of your grace. And as we go along our discussion today, we humbly pray that you would deepen our understanding. Lord, enlighten us and give us wisdom every day. Forgive us for our shortcomings and remind us to always be mindful of the things we do in life. We offer our life and our decisions to you, O Lord. May this gathering today create a memorable experience and a fruitful outcome. We ask this through our Lord Jesus Christ, our Redeemer and our Savior. Amen.
Good afternoon, everyone. From the office of Silliman Online University Learning, I am John Synth Lado Palama, a faculty from the office. So before we begin this session, let me remind everybody to please mute your microphone and rename your Zoom name to your complete name and department so that we can easily identify you. Switch on your video if your connectivity allows you. If you have questions with regard to the presentation, there will be an open forum right after. Please type it in the chat box or use the raise hand reaction button in Zoom and unmute yourself. Before leaving the session, do not forget to fill out the survey. The survey link will be shown later. This will serve as your certificate of attendance and participation. By the way, the session is video recorded. Recordings will be made available at the Silliman Online University Learning website. And in your YouTube channel, just search Silliman Online University Learning. Then kindly subscribe to it so that you can watch the other previous e-trainings that we have conducted. Today, we will have an interesting topic to talk about, creating rubrics using online tools. And our trainer this afternoon is no other than Assistant Professor Alfie Q. Orsalo, a faculty member at the Office of Silliman Online University Learning. Ladies and gentlemen, let's give her our virtual applause. Ma'am Alf, the virtual floor is yours.
Thank you, Sir John, and good afternoon to everyone. Can I share my screen now? Okay, so while I am doing that one. Okay, so there, again, good afternoon and welcome from the Office of the Silliman Online University Learning. Welcome to another fruitful, I hope very fruitful for you as well, afternoon, because we will be dealing with creating rubrics using an online tool. And then I hope everyone is in the pink of health. Kumusta ang tanan? Kumusta? And safe and sound wherever you are. And of course, excited to participate in our activity later on. Okay. So I will start our session with another poll. So let me ask you, what is a rubric for you? How do you define a rubric? And what is your impression of a rubric if you haven't really made one yet? And for those who are already into rubric making, how do you describe a rubric? So kindly, I will just place in the chat box, okay, the link so that everyone could participate. Okay, so kindly do that. Okay. So let me stop sharing first. Okay. So there you go. We'll have 3 minutes of our time to see your answers, how you view rubrics. Okay. So again, kindly click on the link below so that you could access it. Criteria assessment. Okay, I'll try to share the screen so that everyone could see the word cloud. There you go. So, dalawa lang. Okay, so there you go. Marami-rami na. And then many think, no? Many view it as a criteria. Yes, it is. What else? Okay. So it's for checking. Yes, it's used for checking. And then, well, programming in a sense, because if you have to do it online, maybe you think it is quite complex. What else? For scoring, yes. Assessment. Okay, so if you see the words that are bigger, then that means a lot of you have used that one as as your point of view or your definition of what a rubric is. So one more minute before we try to see how well we could classify or how well we could describe what a rubric is. Okay. Yes, it is a tool indeed. And then, yes, it's a guide also when we grade. Okay. So thank you for your answers. Thank you for that. Okay. All right. Okay, so let us try to see if what we have placed in there would reconcile of what really a rubric is. No? So it is an assessment tool. So I've seen their assessment and tool that clearly outlines expectations for students, meaning there's transparency between how you grade them and how they will have to comply with that activity. A rubric describes which performances will be assessed and specifies the criteria for assessing them. And of course, rubrics can be used throughout the process of student work. No, maybe some of us have the notion or the idea that yes, we usually may make use of rubrics only for major projects, but actually they're also very good to use even for formative activities. And because rubrics describe what high performance looks like, they are great tools to help our students gauge their work and provide an opportunity for conversation between students and teachers, because you already have a basis about high quality work. So there you go. Now, how does it help us? Now, as teachers, how does it help us? So first, it provides focus on the desired outcome of the lesson, meaning sometimes when we don't have a rubric, we become subjective to it, no, without even thinking of the objective or the desired learning outcome of that particular activity or project. And then it helps to eliminate distractions, yes, related to the lesson or topic, as I have mentioned earlier. And then it allows for faster and more accurate grading. No, maybe we might have had the experience, like for example, wala tayong rubric, and then we have already graded it in a holistic way, yung without even a criteria on it, and then we have already graded 5, and then here comes a very nice one, a nice work, and then you'll have to go back to the other 5 because you'll have to change your scores. So more or less, it's wasting our time. So if you will have our rubrics, then it will actually make us make grading faster and, of course, more accurate. And especially if our contents for our criteria are very specific. And then it clarifies lesson elements that may need additional attention, meaning because we are focusing on, yes, the objectives of that particular activity, no? There is really clarification when it comes to what needs to be, especially if given in formative assessments, what needs to be focused on for the next activity that will be truly graded. On the other hand, what can rubrics do for our students? So first is it defines the goal of the lesson for students. It's not like gawa lang kayo niyan, okay? For what? Okay? So in here, if you have the rubrics, especially if which is the ideal, we have to show it when we show or when we present the activity to them so that they will also have basis. It specifies the elements that make up the lesson. So meaning they would really see the value and the important points of the lesson because in that activity, it is part of the rubric. And then it allows them to check their work against the rubric to determine if they meet all criteria. Because I have, I am also a teacher to our education students. I am also very thankful that I have them as my students because I really truly feel that they are the ones who are the students who really look into rubrics. And we could really have a conversation because of the rubrics, because they could also have their own inputs to it. Especially if they know the lesson well, they could also have inputs to it. And of course, as teachers, we also have to be open about what they could contribute to a rubric. And then sets up expectations for fairness in grading. So this is actually very, this is like the essence of a rubric for me. It removes the biases, especially if our performance level categories are really very specific. And then, yeah, it really it really diminishes, no, that subjectivity. Okay, so parts of a rubric, and I know everyone is very familiar with this one already. So the upper portion here is what you call the performance levels. This is the one where you place like a word, very good, excellent, outstanding, so on and so forth. And then most of the times we do numbers, or we use numbers, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, how many it is. That part is something that is actually very helpful for us in giving the grade, no, in giving the grade. And then when we have the components or the criteria portion, so the components or the criteria portion is this one. So it's, yeah, you mentioned criteria earlier, so it's really something that will have to go through a criteria. Your grade will have to go through a criteria in order for them to have a score. And then what else? So when you see components of your rubric, they may be varying depending on the goals or what you have for the project of your students, no? However, if you are focusing on processes like writing and research, or utilizing the same rubric, provides consistency and like a common language. So you can use to help students understand goals and work to reach them. So it should be, we should utilize a user-friendly language in order for them to be able to really understand also. Okay. And then rubrics are helpful in quantifying a range of digital products and real world activities, no? Real world tasks. Be sure to consider the effectiveness of communication in the performance, as well as competencies or soft skills gained. So it's not just it's not just about grading them, but also how they performed, no? They performed, it's actually has to be incorporated in your rubric. And then we have content. So content is what makes up the most of it, because it determines the grade for a particular performance or level of performance. Meeting curriculum goals and standards is always an important part of the project work, because most of the times, it is very nice to have a project-based learning with rubrics, and then assessment should reflect the topic and project goals, no? We should include specific criteria to meet the curriculum standards and knowledge requirements. We should not forget that one. We should hit that. And content requirements may also include quality of research, the use of accurate and respected sources. Again, we should not forget that, or we should not make that a minor thing, where they got their resources or where they got their references. And of course, proper citation if we're talking about research. Okay, so we have our basics, no? Basics of rubric designing. Maybe some of you have already like been doing this for years, no? And decades, but really we have to go back to the basics. So a rubric should have 3 or 4 levels of performance. So meaning it should have like 1 to 3, but if we're using like numerical, if you have more than that, then the better. And then a rubric describes which performances will be assessed and specifies the criteria for assessing them. So this can be described numerically or with descriptive terms such as novice, apprentice, proficient, and distinguished. But of course, these descriptions, it might not be applicable if you'll be teaching like grade school or early childhood. We should have like a user friendly or more understandable words to use if we're using descriptive terms. And how you describe these levels should reflect the age and literacy, yes, literacy levels of your learners, as well as the culture of your learning environment. Yeah, if it needs to be in your dialect or in your language, then it's fine for as long as you have placed your performance levels well, and as well as your content. Okay, so we'll have another poll. How do you find making rubrics? Dito na tayo magkakaalaman, no? How do you find making rubrics? Okay, sige. I will stop sharing that. Okay, so you can start answering now. How do you find making rubrics? Let's again spend 2 to 3 minutes on this one. Let's just try to see how you feel. No, how do you feel when you do have to make a rubric from scratch? How do you feel when, well, I have to dig on my yes, on my files, because those are the rubrics are there, but I have to edit them to suit the activity. So how do you find them? Okay. All right. So may nagsabi talaga, exciting. Uh-oh. Okay. Challenging. Okay. I will try to share this one so that everyone could see. Okay. There you go. Challenging. So the biggest statement or the biggest word term is challenging, pragmatic, okay, exciting. So challenging still. There's like comfortably, maybe it's a hassle, arduous, yes. Always challenging, nasa itaas ng ano, challenging, always challenging, no? Okay, fulfilling, yeah, no? Even if it's challenging or might be sometimes a hassle because we had to do this one for an activity that will have to be presented the next day, but fulfilling in a sense that you are giving justice to how you grade your students. Okay, so I guess that's it. Okay. Okay, let's stop sharing that and continue with our discussion before we go to the final online. Okay, so we will be using, for our session this afternoon, we will be using an online tool for rubric making or rubric creation called RubyStar. And let me just present to you some of the things, you know, that we could do with RubyStar. So we have, yes, it is like an app or a tool that we have to like register or log in or log out. Actually, this is voluntary, because you could actually still make your own rubric in RubyStar even if you don't log in. But the perks of logging in is the fact that you could store the rubrics in there when you're not yet done with it. You could still store in there and then maybe edit it later on and just download it when you're done. And then you could actually search rubrics, other rubrics of the same maybe activity that you are trying to make one. But let me just emphasize this, that when you search rubrics in this manner in RubyStar, you could only print it. You cannot download it as like placed in an Excel file. You can only you can only print it, which is actually what's best, because it's not really what we have created, no? What it's actually somebody else's work. And then we could actually just make it a reference, because someone actually answered earlier, it's a reference, no? It's a basis. And then we could choose and edit components, meaning we are talking, when we say choose and edit components, we are talking of the rubrics that we have done and we have saved in there. So we could do that. And then editing rubrics using existing criteria. So this is what's good, because we will emphasize on this one later. Most of the times, in my part, the thing that makes it challenging for me is placing all the components in there. How do I describe each numerical performance level? So that is something that's challenging for me. So in that manner, in here, you could actually create your own by using like a template. Now there's a template. And then creating a new rubric, if you feel like you don't see any that you have clicked on as something that's important or usable to your activity, you could actually create your own new one. But of course, you have to provide your own set of descriptions. And then retrieval of saved rubrics, meaning if you have them like 2-3 years, you could still retrieve it from there if you have your accounts with them. And then of course, you could download rubrics. And later on, when we download our rubrics in Excel file, I will be giving out a bonus. I am actually more concerned of those who do not have a learning management system to place or paste their rubric criteria and descriptions on, and you would want to still be environment friendly in a sense that you would want to just use like your Microsoft Excel to grade them. So later on, we'll do that. It's actually very simple. Okay. So let me stop sharing that one, and then let's now start with our. Okay. Share screen. No. Okay. All right. So there. So the first thing that we'll have to do to go to RubyStar is we'll just have to search for RubyStar. Okay, there. And then you click on this one. So it's rubystar.forteachers.org, but you could just actually use this one. Okay. And in here, this is their main page. So these are the things that we could actually do. So the first thing, if you don't have an account yet, kindly sign up. So click on sign up. Okay. They just need your first or the initial of your name there. And then because we're not from the US, we'll have to use this zip code. It's 5 9s there. Okay. And then you create your password. And of course, whatever email you are using, you could actually place in there. Once you click on register, okay, once you click on register, you are automatically logged in, okay? So let me share to you my screen where I am logged in. Okay, so when you are logged in, you will have this, okay? You will have this one. And just don't mind this portion here. This portion here would mean that the user, like me, I have already logged in. I already have made some rubrics in there. Okay, so there you go. So in here, we'll try to concentrate first in this portion. So when we click on find rubric, okay, when we click on find rubric, we could search for rubrics. As I have mentioned earlier, we could just search and print, not download. Okay, like for example, I would want to click on rubrics for infographic. Okay. So of course it would mean that it will take some time for it to load. Okay, there you go. So for infographic, like there are five pages to view. Okay. You could go through them if you need to see in here. Okay. Now in here, if we click, for example, biology infographics, I will click on this one. Okay. In here, you would see that the only thing that you could do is print this one. So you could make this as the basis if you'd want to make another rubric out of a similar, for a similar activity. So there you go. Another one, let's try another one, because there are also rubrics in here that do not have the contents. Let's just try to see this one. Okay. So for this one, maybe the person was just trying to experiment and didn't place anything in there. So it could actually be also okay if you feel like you just place it through writing. But of course, we'd always want to have a rubric that has like the components or the contents in there in order for us to better grade our students. So let's go back to this one. Okay, for this one, it doesn't have. So this is like, it was really made, but it doesn't have like a set of contents in there. Let's go back to biology infographic. So there, if you click on print page, then you will automatically be able to print it. No? So there, Control P, and then you could print it. So there, Control P in the keyboard, and then you could print it. There you go. So you cannot, again, you cannot, we could not save it as a file. Okay. So after that one, okay, let's click on, we are done with finding rubric or searching for a rubric that would be similar to our activity. We will create our own rubric because we haven't seen or we did not find a rubric that would suit our activity or that would be very relevant for our activity. Let's click on create rubric. Okay, so when you click on create rubric, what's good about here is they're already grouped, no, within their specialization. So if there are oral presentations, you have a set of these ones, and then if it's like a product, this one, and then if by chance there is no such specific activity that is found in here, you could choose the closest one to it so that you could just edit the contents within it. Okay, like for example, I will click on website design because most of the times, especially in senior high school, we get to have our final project with a website design. So I click on that one. Okay, and then I will just place my name. Okay, and then what is the title of your website design rubric? So for mine, it's the local knowledge website. There you go. And then do not forget your zip code, which is 59. Okay. And then you will be asked to choose if you would want this rubric temporary, meaning it will just be there for a week or two, or yeah, when it's actually the default will be if you'd like to keep your rubric for more than a week, then it should be a permanent one. But if you just want it within the week, you could just make it temporary. There you go. So let's make that no, my rubric is permanent. Everything here, by the way, permanent or temporary, if by chance anyone wants to search for that one and clicks on your rubric, they could access it. But again, they could just print it. And in here, we have here our category and it's just 1 to 4. So maybe yours is 5. We will have to edit that one later on because the template will only give us 4. Okay. And then in the category or in the criteria side, if we click the drop down, we have a lot of criteria or yes, category that is applicable to a website rubric. Okay. So graphics, let's choose that one. So once you click on a category, automatically the contents for each performance level will also appear, but you could actually edit that according to your liking. No, so again, if you are very, which is also very good, if you are really making it more numeric within like 4 to 5 graphics only in the main page, so on and so forth, you could actually place it here. And then let's have more. Okay, navigation, is it easy to navigate? Because we're talking of a website. So is it easy to navigate? Does the user have to look for a lot of, or is everything really, really good when it comes to navigating the website? So there you go. And then what else? Links content, did they follow the links that were specified? So you could actually place that one, so on and so forth. Okay. And then, okay, content accuracy, because for me, it's actually local knowledge. So I should be looking into the content if it's really, it's really focusing on local knowledge. So for example, I am complete with that one, no? Or I have these, but I still have more which I couldn't find in here, no? So we will just edit it later on. So for now, this is all that I have seen or that I have picked for my rubric. And then we'll just scroll down. Okay, don't worry if there are so many blanks because it will just disappear once you click on submit. Okay, so there you go. So once you click on submit, you will have a preview of how it looks like, and then you could actually also modify. So when you click on modify, okay, so it's modifying the same set, no? So there you go. You could actually, for example, modify in a sense that maybe you'd go through more modifications within the content. It's also fine. Okay. Sige, let's click on submit again. Okay. And then let's click on home. Sorry, by the way. Why am I logged out? Let me just log in first. Maybe I was timed out. It was timed out. There you go. So my rubric wasn't saved. Okay. So I'll just have to. My teacher home here. So this is the one I got. So if I click on teacher home, that means it's my home page for all the rubrics that I have saved in there. The one that we have saved earlier is here. So I will just click on that one. So you actually, if you want to preview, you could click on that one. If you want to edit, then you could also edit that one. So this is the best way to edit it. So you already have this one, but you still want to add more. So if you want to add more columns, so you click on edit columns. Okay. And then your new column is 5 or maybe 0. It's because you really have like a 0 there. And then if you feel like you still need, because this portion here, try to see this portion here, you would just click, if you need to edit the columns, then you click on this one, okay? But if you need to edit the rows and even your contents, you just click on this one. So there you go. Like for me, I need to add rows, which is like submission. I will click on place organization, and then what else? I have submission, because do they have to submit on time? And then add new rows, and of course they are added automatically. Okay, so how does it look like now? So I will just preview my rubrics here. So it would look like this. But of course, because I added this portion, no, it doesn't have any content when it comes to how you would consider a zero grade. Okay. And then organization here, no, it doesn't also have the contents because it was not part of the template. So of course, when you edit this one, it is your duty to place whatever was not found on the template. So there you go. And then, okay, so for that one, let us try to go back to if we are done with that one, we are set with that one, hopefully we are, okay? For example, we are set with that one, so we click back on teacher home, okay? And then we'll just open this one, okay? We'll just open our rubric. And then it's time for us, because whenever we have changes, of course, we click on save rubric. Whenever we want to print it right away, we could also do that. And then, yes, analyzing rubric would mean how efficient, or yes, is it as a rubric? It's like assessing your own assessment tool. There you go. Okay. And then, how do we download our rubric? Okay. So how will we download that one? Na-mute? Okay, sorry. Okay, how will we download our rubric? Let's click on save rubric. Okay, when we save rubric, we also have these options. This one is quite... Okay. All right, so again, let's go back to downloading our rubrics. So here we could actually download our rubric if we're ready to download it. This time we could really make use of our rubric, especially if we download it as an Excel sheet. So we click on downloads and it's downloaded as an Excel file. Okay, so let me show you. Okay, so let me show you the downloaded rubric. So this is how it would look like. Now, if you would want to use this one, you could actually make use of this one. You can print it. If you would want to use this one offline while grading and not using paper, I will be demonstrating to you how you would be able to make it a bit automatic in a sense that it calculates right away. Like for example, in this one that I have, okay. Let's try to insert more, okay. Okay. So there you go. Okay. So this is the downloaded rubric that I was telling you earlier. So let's try to place a calculator in there so that later on, if you'll be using this one to grade your students, then it will be a breeze because you will just place the scores there and it will automatically calculate at the bottom. No? So what do you do? Okay. So in here, okay, I actually just placed what happens if you open a rubric. Let me see. Okay, so in here, you will just have to place your cursor here. Okay, now you would try to ask what is the overall score, like for example, or the highest possible score of your activity. Of course, it's not just 4 × 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. It's not just that, no? It could be more than that. So for example, this is supposedly 50, no? So the biggest score should be 50. So what will I do first? In this cell, no, you would know which cell you are because you will have to see that in the cell address box there. You will place the equal sign, okay? And then type sum, open parentheses, okay? And then you will just click and drag and stop on the last row of category, release, and then the close parentheses, and then press enter. Okay, so which means, okay, let's make this one bigger. Okay, and then we'll just make it yellow so that you could see it there. So once you place your activities here, it will automatically give you a total here, but that's not the grade here yet. So what you do, okay, at this beside your score, your score with the rubrics, again you press the equal sign, and then so for example that one, for example that, and then what you'll have to do is click on this one, okay? And then, there you go. And then let's place first the biggest scores in here, okay? So these are the biggest scores per category, and you will have like your total also in here for that one. So you could just click on this one and then drag to the right. So that is the total score for this one, for this particular set of, but you would want that this activity will be over 50. So how will you do that? So what you do is you click on the equal sign, okay? And then click on that one, over, this one, okay, and you just times the times symbol is the asterisk, and then you click on this one, okay. So there. So let's try to see if that works. For example, 4, 3, 3. So that is the score of the student, 39.58 over 50. If you want it, you could actually just make it a whole number. So there you go. So you could actually make use of that one. And then if you already have like a template for this one, you could replicate this, or you could duplicate and or make copies depending on the number of students that you have. Okay. So create a copy. So if you have like 40 students, then you have to like, at least you'll just prepare it here. You don't have to like, you don't have to waste paper for 40 of them. And then there you go. So you could just, most of the times when I do this, I'll just have make use, or I will double click on this one and just put the last names of my students. Like for example, there you go. And then you could actually grade them accordingly as what we have done earlier. So there you go. It's really quite easy, no? So any questions before we'll have the activity? Questions? Let me try to share the screen first. Okay. Questions. Okay. If there are no questions, then I think everyone is ready to do the activity. I will give you 20 minutes for that one. I would give you 20 minutes to create your own rubric using a template, just what we had done earlier. And then kindly also download it and then add the formula that we have tried to do. You could have your own highest possible score, if whatever you like, and then save your work, and I will be giving you someone will be giving you the link to the rubrics later on. So timer starts now for the 20 minutes. Okay, so I really hope that someone would be able to do it. I mean, three components would be really easy to do, okay? Or if you feel that the four components are okay with you, then it's fine as well, okay? So time is up. A question here, where to submit the output? Sorry, let me. Okay. Here you could submit the output here. Sorry to everyone. This is for everyone. Here you go. Maybe we could just save the file first, sir, and then close the file before we upload it. Yeah. Some of them have already actually okay. Do you have the same? For those who are still going to upload the file, kindly just save your work and then close the file before you upload it. I will entertain also some questions. Questions earlier from Leila Joy Cason. How do we make a copy if thing that you have searched and then you want to download it? We cannot. We could actually, if you want to download it and it was something that we have made, we click on save your work or the save button, and it will give us the options. Yes. I need to. Okay. Anyway, if you cannot pass it using the link, you could just email it to okay. I've placed it edtech@su.edu.ph. If you cannot pass or upload it using the link, so kindly just email it to edtech@su.edu.ph. Okay. All right. So any more questions before I will give you our final tips for the day? Again, you don't need to worry if it doesn't upload in the link. Just email it to edtech@su.edu.ph. I have placed it in the chat box. Okay. So if there are no more questions, then let's go to our last two slides. Okay. So these are just tips in creating and using our rubric or using rubrics. We should be more specific. And that would mean we have to opt for, or we have to prefer the analytic way of doing rubrics over the holistic way of doing rubrics. So the analytic way is actually what we just did. And then we have to make sure to include the specific learning targets and objectives. That is very important so that you would want your students to meet or learn while they're doing the activity. That's the essence of also making the rubric, because you are really targeting the objectives. And then while there are many different pathways to get there or different ways to demonstrate their knowledge, they need to somehow show you that they met that standard. I mean, performance task, especially for SBE. And then try having students co-create the rubric, no? That's what I mentioned earlier with me having education students. I am also open to them suggesting categories or criteria as part of our rubric. Also, that would also, sometimes students feel like they have no say, no, in what they learn or accomplish because it's already given to them right away. So allowing them to create the rubric with you gives them a voice also, and also holds them accountable to their own standards, meaning, okay, so this is actually valid. So we will include that one. And then not just, it doesn't just make them feel empowered that they were part of making the rubric, but of course they define their, they also help in defining the standards that's put on the activity and of course the lesson. And then we also have, we have to use student-friendly language. That's why I also mentioned this earlier, that we shouldn't be using very complicated words or terms if we have to be making use of rubrics for early childhood or primary school. Maybe for many of you who are into, who are teachers of the elementary school and early childhood, maybe you'll make use of symbols instead of descriptions. So there. And then lastly, now this is very important so that they won't be able to, they wouldn't be able to like maybe forgo some of the important points in the project because it was given to them not prior to the making, the formal making of the activity. So this would really help the students because they need to know what the grading criteria are prior to turning in the assessment. Of course, because they would want to meet that standards, so they should be able to see the criteria in order for it to in order for them to execute them. And don't have students wait until the end to look at it, no? After na sa activity nila makikita ang rubrics. May rubrics pala. And then halfway through the project or assignment, have students check in. Maybe you would give them a reminder. Have you seen this these rubrics or this category or this criteria? Try to see, because from what I have been looking at, hindi pa masyadong focus doon. And then you could actually also tell them, are you meeting this criteria? Especially if there is like, you could also view their work in progress. And then you could have them self-assess or do a peer assessment, which is actually something that I always do, especially with collaborative work. so that they can see what to improve on before it gets to you for final assessment. And this should greatly increase the quality of their work and save, of course, your grading time later. Okay, so that's it for the afternoon. By the way, I will show you one output from a teacher, Ma'am Maipa. Okay, let me see. Okay, so this is her work. Okay, so it's actually a pre-production video. For again, it's because she's teaching she's teaching empowerment technologies and incorporating local knowledge in the project, the final project. So she has like 6 or 8. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Categories for her rubric, and then she wants it that the highest possible score would be 100. So what she did is okay. So let's just place, or let's just have the one, the grade that she made for me, because she had she actually also made four copies of the sheet for students. Okay, so she placed the score there. Okay, and then it's within the rubric's scoring, it's actually 28 over 32, but because she placed the formula so that it will be over 100, so the score for me, the one she gave for me, is actually 88 over 100. So this is something also that's also, it will actually help you save time, because if you'll do the calculations using your manual calculator, you still have to, you have to spend time doing it. But if you have this one, you'll just make that particular formula once, and then you'll just have to copy it all throughout the copied, it will be part of the copied sheet, so it will be very time efficient for you. Okay, so okay. All right. So that is it for us in the afternoon. Daghang salamat sa tanan for attending. Sir Fredley? Sir John? Okay. So Sir John, kindly place the link for the evaluation for this one in order for us to get our certificate of participation. If we click on the survey and answer it, but addition, if you click on the, or if you submit or email us your output, then it will be a certificate of completion for you, for everyone. So thank you everyone, thank you. Okay. Thank you and good afternoon. Thank you very much. Oh, we'll still have, because we want to see your beautiful and handsome faces, we'll have our photo opportunity. Anyway, we still have a very long time. We have a lot of time for that one. So kindly turn on your Sir, can we just have the screen so that everyone will be in gallery view? Okay. Okay. Kindly please. Now I see the beautiful and handsome faces of our participants. Okay. Hi, moms and sirs. We'll meet again eventually if we'll have another open webinars. Thanks for always joining us. Sir, kindly.
Okay, so in the count of three, say cheese. One, two, three. Cheese. Okay, another one. Smile. One, two, three. Okay.
Okay, so thank you, everyone. Bye-bye.
Thank you.